That the Lord has made. We are and will continue to rejoice and be glad in it. Our thought for February 2021 is kingdom citizens must know that we should reach across barriers of racial and ethnic differences to break every yoke of division and to promote unity in the kingdom for all persons, regardless of their social status. Our scripture will be coming from Leviticus, the 19th chapter, starting with verse 30. Keep my Sabbath day of rest and show reverence towards my sanctuary. I am the Lord. Do not defile yourselves by turning to mediums or to those who consult the spirits of the dead. I am the Lord, your God. Stand up in the presence of the elderly and show respect for the age. Fear your God, I am the Lord. Do not take advantage of foreigners who live among you in your land. Treat them like native-born Israelites and love them as you love yourself. Remember that you were once foreigners living in the land of Egypt. I am the Lord your God. Do not use dishonest standards when measuring length, weight, or volume. Your scales and weights must be accurate. Your containers for measuring dry materials or liquids must be accurate. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt. God's word for God's people.
Amen.
Go ahead.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, once again, we come into your presence, Lord, just to say thank you, to praise your holy and righteous name, Father, and to give you the thanks, Father, that you deserve.
Yes.
As we go through this pandemic and other issues in our life, Father, we lean and depend on you, call on your holy and righteous name, Father. You said in your word, Lord, to cast our cares upon you, so we bring them all to you, Father. We have sick and shut in, hungry and homeless and bereaved everywhere. And we just ask, Lord, that you just have mercy on us, Lord, that you continue to teach us and guide us. Help us to understand, Lord, and take care of one another as you have done for us, Lord. Father, we ask, Lord, that you bless and take care of our church families, our pastors and our leaders, Father, and their families also. So as we go into this, Lord, we ask that you continue to have mercy on us, that you continue to teach us, that you will strengthen us, bless us, and have mercy on us, Father. Teach us to be merciful also, Lord. And Father, as we go forth into this life, we know we got issues. We ask that you have mercy, that you take care of them, Father, that you show us how to do things, that we would always humble ourselves and pray to seek your face and turn from our wicked ways, Lord, so that you will hear from heaven, Father, and heal the land. Father, in Jesus' name we pray and we thank you, Father. We thank you right now for all the things that we are going through, because, Lord, we know that you are in charge. We know that you have all power in your hands and that you can do all things, Lord. So we lean and depend on you, Father. We know, Lord, that we have other nations and other people going through the same thing, Lord. So we just ask, Father, that you bring us all together in one accord, Father, to listen to you and do what you would have us to do. Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray and we thank you, Lord, for our families and loved ones, Lord. Wherever they may be, whatever they may be doing, Lord, help them, Lord, to know that you are in charge. So, Lord, as we go into this day now, we say thank you and we praise your holy and righteous name. And we thank you for all that you've done for us and what you're doing and what you're going to do, Lord. Then we ask, Lord, that you strengthen us, Father, and guide us and lead us in your way. Father, in Jesus' name, we pray and we thank you now for everything. Amen. Hallelujah.
Greetings, Kingdom citizens. It's with great pleasure that we join you today, virtual, for this awesome, awesome worship experience. We like to bring before you a couple of announcements as you also prepare to give in a little while. Our first announcement is concerning our small group classes. We want to thank you for participating in our small groups, and if you're not a part of a small group, we ask that you please, please get connected, join a small group. If you have any young people that are not connected with a small group, we have small group classes for all ages, for all of our young people, and so we would love for you to contact myself or contact one of the facilitators for the children and youth, young adults, and get involved, because this is our Bible study for this season that we find ourselves in. And our groups are growing, our groups are learning, and so we ask that you be a part. We also want to announce that we will be celebrating Black History Month. We will be celebrating Black History Month for the month of February, of course. And there are several events planned, and you will be seeing those events posted on the web. You will get e-blasts giving dates and times of specific services. We also will be handing out flyers at the drive-in service. And we ask that you come and be a part of our drive-in service. If you've not experienced our drive-in, we ask that you come, because we are having a great time in the Lord. Amen. God has been good. God has been great, as a matter of fact. We also want to give you a insight on our beginning of Lent services, which will begin on February 17th. We will be still having Lent services in some form. Of course, we will do things differently as we've been doing in the past, as we've been doing all that most of last year and beginning of this year. So please be on the lookout for messages about how we will do our Lent services. There will be some changes and some dynamic services coming in February. So please, please be on the lookout for those things. Also, we want to encourage you encourage you to get the vaccine as soon as it becomes available to you. We would love for you to protect yourself the best that you can by going through the proper channels and taking that vaccine. We know that God is protecting and God is keeping us, but God also directs us to do some things, preventive measures. He uses doctors, and so they've come up with this vaccine, and we need to use it. Too many people are losing their lives, and so it's time that we do our very best. Amen. 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 So it's giving time. Let's pray about our giving. Father in heaven, we thank you for this opportunity to sow into your kingdom. Pray your blessings upon the gifts and the giver. In the mighty name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Amen. Of course, there's several ways that you can give. You can give by going to the church's website, jehovahbaptist.org, and go to the Givelify, and you can send it in that way. You can also mail it in, mail your tithes in to the church here at 803 South Harbin Street, Sumter, South Carolina, 29150. Your tithes will be received that way. Or you can stop by the church. Stop by, and there's a receptacle in the lobby that you may drop your tithes off. Because we have to keep growing. And you know that we are in a building project. And we are moving forward. And we need your financial support. But not only that, but because it's a way of sowing into the kingdom of God, that God might even bless your life. Because the scripture says, give and it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, shall men give unto your bosom. So the more you give to God, the more he'll give to you. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much. May God bless you, and may God keep you.
Good morning, Kingdom citizens. Welcome to our worship service, our message today. You've been welcome. The worship service has been going on for a little bit, so it's good to see have each one of you with us today. Happy Valentine's Day. Gentlemen, I hope that you didn't forget your duties. Pandemic does not dismiss you from your duties. You still have work to get done for Valentine's Day. And to all the ladies in our congregation, and specifically to my wife, happy Valentine's Day, dear. 2021 theme here at Jehovah says that kingdom citizens striving to advance the kingdom of God on earth as it is in heaven. Our focus this month, our emphasis, is building bridges and creating new relationships across racial lines. Our thought for the month, kingdom citizens must know that we should reach across barriers of racial and ethnic differences to break even or every yoke of division and to promote unity in the kingdom for all people, regardless of their social status. At the heart of our lesson this month is be kind to, or this week is be kind to strangers. Some of you will recognize two names I'm about to mention, and some of you may not. The first one I want to mention is a young man named Akeem Olajuwon. He was born in 1963, is a Nigerian-American and a former professional basketball player from 1984 to 2002. He played center in the NBA for the Houston Rockets and the Toronto Raptors. He led the Rockets to back-to-back NBA championships in 1994 and 95. In 2008, he was inducted into the Basketball Hall of Fame. Olajuwon was a great center. For those of you that are my age or older, you'll remember him. He was a great player, a very dominant player. The second person I want to mention is a guy named Dirk Nowitzki. He was born in Germany. He's listed as 7 feet tall. He's widely regarded as the best power forward of all times and is considered by many to be the greatest European players of all times. He won an NBA title with the Dallas Mavericks. Nowitzki is the only player ever to play for a single NBA franchise for 21 years. Or for 21 seasons. He is a 14-time All-Star and a 12-time All-NBA team member. He's the first European player to start in an All-Star game and the first European player to receive the NBA Most Valuable Player Award. Nowitzki is the highest-scoring foreign-born player in NBA. History, the highest scoring foreign player in NBA history. Again, our heart of our Bible study this week is be kind to foreigners. My message title today is treat the foreigner among you with kindness and compassion. Treat the foreigner among you with kindness and compassion. How are men like Olajuwon and Nowitzki received when they first entered the U.S. or first entered the NBA? For neither spoke what we would consider American English the way that we do. And I'm not sure how much English they actually knew. They came because of their basketball skills. Were they received with open arms and welcoming smiles, or were there sneers and jeers because they were different, they looked different, and they sounded different? Often, as Americans, we do not know how to respond to those who are different from us. But when we look back at these men, and they are only a representative group, we now see a huge contribution to the American game of basketball. If we had rejected them because they were different, we would have missed enjoying their skills and talents. They were both outstanding players, very different kinds of players, but outstanding players. Again, be kind to the foreigner. But our lesson today focuses on treat the foreigner among you with kindness and compassion. Treat the foreigner among you with kindness and compassion. Leviticus 19, my focus verses today are verses 33 and 34. However, this section of the book of Leviticus gives a lot of guidelines and directions for living daily life, some things that God expects of his people, or at this point, he expected of the Israelites. God expected the Israelites to do some things, and the verses that we're going to look at, verses 33 and 34, we're going to see some of the things that he said to them specifically that he wanted them to do. I would say to people, if I'm telling you to do something, then you can listen off and on, you can text while I'm talking, or you can do something else. But if God is speaking, you need to put all that gadgetry down and listen to what he's saying. Those gadgets don't mean anything if God is speaking. Leviticus 19, verse 34. When a foreigner resides among you in your land, do not mistreat them. The foreigner residing among you, you must be treated as a native born. Love them as yourself, for you were foreigners in Egypt. I am the Lord your God. We're told we should treat foreigners and aliens. We are told how we should treat foreigners and aliens. And someone might ask, well, how do I treat the foreigner among me with kindness and compassion? And I would say to you, I'm glad you asked. The Lord says several things to us in this verse, and they are very clear and they are very direct. Trust me when I tell you, as we look at this passage, there is nothing complicated. You don't need a Greek or Hebrew dictionary. You don't need any professor or anyone who has a PhD or a doctorate to tell you. It is very simple what God would expect from the Israelites in reference to how they treated others. Now, where you are, you might say, well, there are no foreigners around me. But there are people around you who are different from you. And so the question then becomes, how are you treating people around you? You know, the people who have less than you have. The people who live in a house that may not be their own or may not be as nice as your house. The people that don't have their own personal transportation. The people that have lost their job. How do you treat others who may be in a different situation than you are in? And sooner or later, because America is a nation of immigrants, sooner or later you're going to come across somebody, if you have not already done so, who is different from you, racially, culturally, and the list goes on. They may have a lighter hue than you are, a darker hue. They may have different texture of hair. They may speak differently. They may have an accent. They may not know any English, and so they're different. So the first thing, as you ask the question, how do I treat the foreigners among me with kindness and compassion? According to the scriptures in verse 33, he says, do not mistreat them. He says, when a foreigner is among you in the land, do not mistreat them. That's the first thing. Everybody knows what it means to be mistreated. You go to school and someone steals your lunch money. You have been mistreated. You come into the church and you look for someone to help you or show you some, give you some ideas or surround you with love, and they kind of blow you off. You feel mistreated. Why do we mistreat those from foreign lands? I think that one of the reasons we probably do it is because we've gotten used to being here, and we think, we act like we've always been here. And we've not always been here. We are a nation of immigrants. These people would fall into the category of the most vulnerable among us. They are often cheated, picked on, and toyed with. We have a habit of giving them our worst and using them for our pleasure. But God says, do not mistreat the foreigner. And he talks about this a little bit more in just a minute. So the question then becomes, as an individual, as a Christian, are you or have you mistreated somebody who is a foreigner? Whether the person is Asian or Hispanic, whether the person is European or someplace else, whether the person is even African, have you mistreated the foreigners? You know, sometimes we look at people and we treat them based on outward appearance. You know, a lot of our decisions about people are made based on outward appearance, and many times when we assume things about people, we are absolutely 100% wrong. And then we feel that we have the right to treat them as if they are not human beings or that they are subhumans. Now, can I just tell you this before I move to my second point? And that is this. God sees what we are doing, and he is not pleased with it when we treat others in a harsh and an unkind and a way that is not compassionate. So God is looking at us. Secondly, again, going from the text, verse 34, you must treat them like you would someone who was born here. It says that the foreigner residing among you must be treated as your native born. The foreigner among you must be treated as your native born. You know, we say, well, okay, we are Americans, and so we deserve this, and these things belong to us, and these foreigners are coming here, and they are getting things that belong to us. And again, can I just tell you that we are all foreigners, except for the Native Americans, we are all foreigners in this land. I don't care if your family has been here for 400 years, we are all foreigners and immigrants in America. And so God says to us, you are to treat them as you would someone born here. Have you ever gone overseas, whether it was for work or for a vacation, and you saw a group of native people looking in your direction and laughing? How did that make you feel? Let me ask you another question. Have you ever seen a group of foreigners in this country and you and your friends start to laugh at them because of their speech or their dress or their hairstyle or whatever else? But we will return. Yeah, how do you feel when they laugh at you? I don't think that you felt good. I know I wouldn't feel good. But sometimes what we do is when we see people that are different from us, we look in their directions and do the same thing that has happened to us when we've gone overseas. Sometimes we will go to Walmart or Penny's and we see people that seem to be lost. Sometimes they're trying to figure out certain things, and we will not help them, but rather we will poke fun at them. God says, treat them like one of us. Help them like you would one of your friends. Mm-hmm. I think sometimes for us as people, different scares us because we don't understand what different is and why they are different.
Yeah.
But God loves the foreigner. And aren't you glad that God loves the foreigner? Because if God didn't love the foreigner, God wouldn't love you. And he wouldn't love me. But God loves the foreigner. So God said, treat them like they are born in your land. In other words, he said, treat them like your sisters and brothers, and treat them like your children and your cousins. Don't treat them like they are some kind of thing that came from Mars, a creature that came from Mars. They are people just like you. Hispanic people love their children just like you do. Asian people love their children just like you do. Africans love their children just like you do. They all have feelings.
Yeah.
Now, as African Americans, we ought to be the last group in this country to mistreat anybody.
That's right.
Because we know what it means to be mistreated. We know what it feels like to be mistreated over and over again, to be minimized and marginalized over and over again. So we need to stop treating people like they are from another planet, and we need to treat them with the love of God. Again, do not mistreat them. Again, treat them as native born. My third and final point is this: love them as you love yourself. The second part of verse 34 says, love them as yourself, for you were foreigners in Egypt. I am the Lord your God. Love them as you love yourself. This is one of the great challenges of life. One of the great challenges of life is loving others as we love ourselves. And God is saying, you give to them and you act toward them the same way you would want someone else to act toward you.
That's right.
The Lord just doesn't say tolerate them. Listen to that. He just doesn't say tolerate them or help them with your leftovers, or your leftover time or leftover resource, but love them as you love yourself.
Yeah.
In fact, these are the same words that Jesus or the Apostle Paul used in the New Testament. What Jesus did first. Jesus said the great commandment is to love God.
Yeah.
He said the second one is just like the first one. You are to love your neighbor as yourself.
Yeah.
Paul picks this up in Ephesians chapter 5, and he says a man ought to love his wife as he loves himself. God is saying, I'm calling you to love the foreigner, the alien. I'm calling you to love the refugee the same way that you love yourself.
Mm-hmm.
What concerns you have for your household, then you ought to have those same concerns for the household of foreigners. There are foreigners, there are refugees, there are aliens among us, and they are real people.
Yeah.
Yeah, let's not miss that. Let's not miss that. Just because I'm different doesn't mean I'm not human.
That's right.
As I bring this message to a close, I mentioned I opened talking about Olajuwon and Nowitzki, who are great basketball players. Well, I was never a great basketball player. I've always loved basketball, but I was never a great player. In fact, I would say I was never a good player. I was a fair player. I was a fair player, that's who I was. And so when I was a child, and there was a pickup game in the community, guess who got picked last? Over and over and over again, if I got picked at all.
Yeah.
You see, we tend to leave those out that we don't consider to meet up to our standards.
Yeah.
But God has included us in what he's doing.
Yeah.
And that's why I'm so glad today to be a Christian, because God does not see as man sees. All man sees is what you look like on the outside. Oh man, you too big to move. You too this to do that. But God sees what's on the inside. And God has something for us that's greater than what people see on the outside.
Yeah.
So some might say, I'll ask the question, why should we do this, Lord? Why should we treat foreigners and refugees and aliens like we treat ourselves, love them as we love ourselves? His response is simply this: because I am the Lord your God.
Yeah.
You see, if I'm telling you something, you can disregard me. If Pastor Newton or Pastor Simmons tells you something, you might be able to disregard it.
Yeah.
But if you ever hear these words, thus saith the Lord, you better stop and stand up and listen to what God is saying.
That's right.
Because you are about to receive something that you are going to need.
Yeah.
And God says, do not mistreat the foreigner. God says you treat them as a native born. God says you love them as you love yourself. And you say, why? God said, because I am the Lord your God, and I have commanded you to do so.
Yes, sir.
My brothers and sisters, are you willing to treat the foreigner among you with kindness and compassion?
Mm-hmm.
Like Olajuwon and Nowitzki, we need to extend kindness and compassion to every foreigner just because the Lord said so.
Yes, sir.
God bless you. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. We honor you. We adore you, God. You are great. Thank you, Lord, that we were foreigners and strangers. God, we were set aside. We were ostracized, marginalized, minimized, and you came our way one day. You didn't let what others said about us stop you from coming and rescuing us. And we were rescued from darkness and brought into your kingdom, God, and we say thank you today.
Thank
you. God, you've adopted men and women and boys and girls from every nation and tribe and every tongue, God, that we are part of what you're doing in the earth.
Yeah.
And so we give you great glory and honor and praise that you don't see as man sees, but you see not what we are, but what we can become. Because of your power at work within us. We love you, honor, and adore you now. In the name of Jesus. Amen. My brothers and sisters, this is a great message today for anyone and everyone. Because we are foreigners and strangers on our way to heaven. The reality is, we could never go to heaven unless one who had been there would come to earth and redeem us and say, you can come. And so because Jesus has come, and as the old folk would say, and has tabernacled among us, then we now have the opportunity to go where he is. Jesus said it simply this way: I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. I want to ask you, my brothers and sisters, as you're watching this service today, as you heard this message, have you ever come from being a foreigner to becoming a part of the family of God? Have you come from being a stranger to being a son or a daughter of God? If you've never done that, this is your day. You are certainly in the right place, and this is the right time. Would you open your heart to the Lord and ask him to come in to forgive you your sins and be your Savior? And if you make that commitment, would you call the number on the screen? We want to connect you with some spiritual resources so that you can begin to grow in Christ. My brothers and sisters, just because you hear the message, it doesn't mean that you have salvation. Just because you took communion last Sunday, it doesn't mean you have salvation. Jesus told a very religious man, one probably much more religious than many of us, Nicodemus, he said, you must be born again. My brothers and sisters, have you have a born-again experience? And if you have not, today can be your day. Maybe you, at some point, as a friend of mine did years ago, received Christ as a Savior, but then he walked away from God. For many years, he did. But last week, I got word from him that he had come back to the Lord. I want to say to somebody today, I don't care how long you've been away from God. God has not moved. He's still where he was the last time you left him. So you can come back today. But you must make that decision. And then if you need a church home, please call the church here. We will connect you with our leaders that will minister with you and to you. And we will connect you to ministry. And we will connect you to study. Because you need to be able to grow in the faith. Again, make sure that you contact the church. God bless you. Heaven smile upon you. Amen.